Thank you, Emma, very much indeed. You're so lovely. Thank you. Before I start, I'd like to have a few more thank yous because a lot of people have been very much involved in the research I've been doing, both recently and over time. Mainly, I want to acknowledge Ming Liang, who has worked with me since 2003 and has just been with me in Guangzhou. But I'd also like to thank Stefan Solomon, Tracy Mullen and Eleanor Kaufman from Middlesex, Enda Murray, who's just finished his doctorate at UWS but is also a filmmaker and has worked with us here, Inara Waldron, Joe Chipperfield, Cholta Tung, Gerald Seek, Natalie Pendova, Liu Shufu, and Teacher Deng, and of course the ARC, the Leverhulme Network, the iCinema Research Centre, and my home school, the School of Humanities and Languages, led by the completely wonderful Vanessa Lem. There's no place like home, child migrants in world cinema. If we walk far enough, said Dorothy, we shall sometime come to some place, I'm sure. Stories matter. If they didn't, we wouldn't tell them and we wouldn't listen, read and retell them with such intensity and pleasure. Stories give us clues to what else we are, who else we might possibly become. Stories explore what we are frightened of and what we want most. Tonight I want to talk about a set of stories which help me make sense of a worldwide, long-term phenomenon, child migration. In the main, these are stories imagined and achieved through feature films or through documentary. There are others that started as books, for adults or for children. Films you may have seen, and perhaps some others that have passed you by. There are others too that have been made in the course of my project, as Emma mentioned, by refugee children in Sydney and in London, migrant workers' children in southern China, and by Indigenous girls in New South Wales, whose long journeys to and from boarding school are a kind of continued migration between home and the city. Thinking about home, about journeys, and about transformations wrought by mobility, they have crafted their own statements on film about friendship, zombies, ghosts in the school bathroom, and the overwhelming experience of attending religious ceremonies in a new environment for the first time. Watching them make these short films has allowed me to learn from young people with such huge life experience already under their belts, to see how mobility changes outlooks and expectations, and how arrival in a new place can be both terrifying and energizing. So before we look at the world cinema made by adults, let's take a quick look at world cinema made by child migrants.
Hi, my name is Vinita. I'm new in this class.
Hi, Vinita, how are you?
Good.
Have a seat, please.
Thank you. So, what are we going to do?
Students, please pay attention because we're going to speak about poetry today. Dilaksha, stop doing that.
Okay. Miss Wanga was throwing the paper to me.
Calm down. I'll fix your problem. Just ignore her, darling. Okay.
I miss my old school.
Hey, do you want to play with me? Okay, go with me.
Looking at an archive or a canon of works or a collection of similarly themed movies is more than an act of individual scholarship. It contributes to a collective historical responsibility that we all share. For those interested in the continuing impacts of history on the present, as that is made visible and audible on film, cinema provides an emotional and narrational vocabulary by which we might explain ourselves to ourselves, and thereby to our fellow citizens and other human beings. Cinema at its best asks us to recognize ourselves on screen, singly and collectively, For me, the child migrant is an embodiment of human courage and adaptivity. She is the quintessential cosmopolitan. Cosmopolitanism in such cases does not suggest an elite category of borderless, globe-trotting, capital-rich travellers, nor federated political idealism inexplicably cushioned from the furies and passions of nationalist and ideological community, nor even, or not simply, the general Kantian figure of a peaceful sojourner and traveller in a shared world space, who may claim, and I quote Kant, of course, the privilege of strangers arriving on foreign soil, a right that underpins a desirable cosmopolitan constitution between states. Rather, the child cosmopolitan of much migration history is a grassroots, grounded person, a cosmopolitan by necessity, emerging from unintended or inescapable circumstance, which may be, as the British cultural and postcolonial theorist Paul Gilroy says, uncomfortable to contemplate, and for the child might well have been downright dangerous to survive. Survival is itself a cosmopolitan enterprise, a complicated and ongoing challenge. The child migrant has a whole life to build. She must be open to the world in which she finds herself, and thus find ways to subtly contest the powerful fantasies of adult authority that keeps children in their place. That is, she must learn how she might create a space of arrival and settlement in which she belongs, where she's claimed both public and private rights, where she is, in short, at home. Two stories in particular have prompted this project. Both have young women as central protagonists, young women who make extraordinary journeys away from and in search of a place called home. The first is Dorothy, the heroine of Frank L. Baum's Oz series, and the first edition was May the 17th, 1900, exactly 61 years before I was born. Dorothy, most famously played by Judy Garland in the 1939 film The Wizard of Oz, is forced away from her dingy, poverty-stricken home by a tornado. When she lands in the Technicolor world of Oz, she finds that her identity has been recast on her arrival in foreign lands. Where before she was a young girl whose main concern was saving her dog from the petty meanness of a local neighbor, now she is a white witch, with one dead witch to her credit and a whole federation of small states to liberate. She's escaped the danger of her origins, namely extreme weather events and agricultural poverty, only to discover fantastic dangers, witches, wizards, and bewitched flying monkeys. Dorothy has, if you like, disassociated through her dream and reconnected to her possible self through a fantasy of omnipotence, which materializes in the books and in the film as silver or ruby slippers, a golden cap, and her indomitable belief in home. The Wizard of Oz, argues Salman Rushdie, the novelist, is a film that speaks of two great challenges in life. Migration is one, growing up is the other, each of which requires a child to take possession of her own future, and both of which lead inexorably to a place, perhaps a new place, called home. The child migrant must overcome the vulnerabilities of being both young and foreign, and often without adult assistance. She must have enough of an imagination to hold faith in the idea of a better future, whilst dealing with the long weeks and months, in some cases years, of travel, detention, camps, without any of the ordinary securities of home, school and community networks to rely on. In one interview with a 13-year-old Afghani boy in London, as we discussed the use of colour in film to provoke emotion, he told us that for him, brown was the colour he saw before his eyes and in his head when people couldn't and wouldn't understand him, what he said and what he felt. He wanted to make a big movie one day, he went on, about border-crossing bandits in the desert between Peshawar and Kabul. He wanted to get that brown out of his head and onto the screen, to make himself really well understood. Dorothy's dream also helps her escape from sepia to technicolor. So looking at film, We can also look past the difference between fantasy and actual experience and recognize children dealing with change on many levels simultaneously. We can acknowledge the impact of mobility between worlds concurrently experienced with generational change and maturation. Oz is an elaborate metonym for cinema and its inescapable capacity for such multifaceted revelation. Now, Dorothy's adventure in Oz has been elsewhere interpreted as an early expression of United States colonial adventure. Dorothy goes out in a tornado, causes a degree of havoc, and then asks to go home again. Indeed, that version has been explored obliquely in Claire Denis's White Material. A French African ex-colony is in turmoil. Child soldiers roam the countryside and die of inadvertent overdoses. Their tiny bodies sprawled like unlucky Dorothy's in the poppy fields. The adult lead, Maria, played as Girl Woman, which is very reminiscent of Dorothy, of course, also played by Girl Woman, in this case, Isabelle Huppert, runs back to her coffee plantation despite the warnings of French soldiers evacuating white stayers on, whilst the new independent state is in the throes of a post-colonial civil war. There's one particular scene that sets up these brutal references to The Wizard of Oz. Maria, an adult, dressed, not in this particular scene, she's not in a dress, but often she wears a childish dress, and she's alone on this yellowish dust road, and although actually far from home, she thinks of herself as the Queen of Oz, rather than the wicked white witch that Oz is seeking to expel. Wrongly, she imagines herself indomitable against all the odds of an indigenous population under arms. She misrecognizes the winged monkeys, here French helicopters, as enemies, whereas these buzzing machines are not her enemies, but her co-conspirators and her saviors. In the book, it is the wearer of the golden cap who commands the monkeys. It's Dorothy, who snatched it from the wicked witch of the East after she's killed her. And she makes them fly her to the wizard, who in turn, of course, sends her home to Kansas. But that version, compelling and confronting as it is the one where Dorothy carries the original sin of colonial responsibility. It forgets that Dorothy in Baum's story is a rural girl in an earlier USA beset with turn-of-the-century class warfare, internal migrations, and huge poverty. So for me, Dorothy is a migrant on the right side of 18, a child becoming something other, not an adult after all, but a child who assumes sudden, extreme, and occasionally violent responsibility. Whereas in Kansas, she could not save her dog from an adult, here she must save herself and others from their own demons and from really bad magic. She has some magic on her side, of course, but in the end, it's her strength that gets her through and gets her home. Indeed, for me, Dorothy is the urtext of the child-woman adventurer, and I do stretch that to boys. She's the cinematic figure who becomes more cosmopolitan the more she is repeated across the decades of world cinema. So, The Wizard of Oz is an organizing text for thinking about migration. It clearly sets out the stages of every journey, place of origin and the problems that beset it, the decision to leave, Dorothy setting off down a road with Toto before the tornado takes over, departure, journey, arrival, the long, long process of settling, and then perhaps sometimes remigration. In a 1925 film version of The Wizard of Oz, Dorothy stays in Oz and becomes a queen. In the 1939 film, Dorothy, of course, never settles, and indeed spends most of the film, trying to get home again. Her departure from Kansas, you will remember, is forced, sudden, terrifying. The place called home is rendered totally unsafe by an external incident. For tornado, read climate disaster, war, famine, family breakdown. Adults disappear into a hole and shut the door against her, whilst the wind tears apart the material fabric of her world. Her journey is a haphazard whirlwind, a whirling house with just two dear possessions, a dog and a basket. The journey is a continuation of the confusion of her departure, and it goes on after arrival. One of the aspects of experiencing migration firsthand is that you know it's a process, it's not a defined action, it doesn't end soon. There's much more that one can say about Dorothy, her relationship with those three strangers on the road, the first opaque encounter with the city, and the unimaginable tasks she set by the wizard in order to regain her right to go home. We can imagine that similar tasks are set for the right to stay put. My second inspiration is Ruth Belitzka. Ruth is a character in Ian Sorelia's children's novel about the Second World War in Europe, The Silver Sword. Ruth is the eldest child in a small group of escapees from Warsaw, where the right to the city has been violently withdrawn. She personifies grace under duress, but also experiences the accelerated maturation of growing up in wartime with sudden, extreme responsibility for the survival of others. Ian Sorelia, who lived from 1912 to 1994, was a schoolteacher, children's author, and a Quaker living in the south of England. After the European War ended in 1944, photographs of displaced people, many of them children, began to be published in magazines and in international reports. He found an image from a UNESCO publication called Children of Europe particularly disturbing. A boy looks past the camera, prematurely aged, despairing, wary, suspicious. His face bears a version of the thousand-yard stare attributed to battle-worn, traumatized soldiers. This boy may be 8 or 9 or 10 years old, but maybe older, because malnutrition keeps people young in all the wrong ways. He survived a war, but he survived up to the moment the photograph's been taken, that's all we know. But his childhood seems lost. Similar images were included in a recent exhibition of war photography at the Museum of Contemporary Arts in Houston. And this one particularly was distressing, I found. It's a girl survivor, again presumably from camps or years of hiding. She stares wildly towards the camera, her eyes more demented than the thousand-yard stare, perhaps beyond even that despair, from a blackboard where he scribbled an image of her life to date. It's a mass of chalk, lines crisscrossing, a tornado of despair. Sorelia wrote The Silver Sword as a response to the impact of the war on childhood. His book is remarkable, I think, on three counts. First, he noticed that not only were children dying in war, they were also surviving, but that the survival was at the expense of the idea of childhood. Second, he focused his attention on children who traveled alone, without adults, ideally to recoup a place called home. Third, he spoke to his intended readers, children, as though they would understand that children suffer as well as triumph, that real adventures incur real danger, that fantasy is based on fear as well as hope. Thus, simply, his contribution to the story of that war and every war placed childhood and children at the center of their own story. His work is echoed in the reports on children in war researched and published by UNESCO from 1995 that tell us bluntly the impact of conflict on the young. Every separation creates trauma. Each time a child is given an M16 to fight with, and they note that light arms have meant that children are increasingly used as warriors in war zones worldwide. Each time a child picks up a butterfly mine thinking it may be a toy, we've killed another piece of humanity's future. And there is no way to overstate the case for our shame. The child migrant is herself and himself in the world today. She's been here before, and she's still walking across borders, or roaming in camps, or drawing pictures of despair and hope, or trying to make a new life in a new place with new people. She's also a powerful fantasy structure of escape and infantile freedom devised by adult storytellers or framed by adult documentarists to embody and aestheticize wish fulfillment, accelerated motion, socio-political displacement, and ontological transition, all of which conditions generate adult anxiety, desire, and fear. So, Dorothy and Ruth. Ruth is a Dorothy, and Dorothy foreshadows a Ruth. Names we recognize and cling to. And there is also, if you've read the book, Ruth's little sister, Bronya, the plucky, funny child who seems to survive with her soul intact. She might also be the little Paulette from René Clément's 1952 Les Jeux Interdits, or Forbidden Games, a beautiful orphan child carrying her pet dead dog killed on the road as she leaves the chain of refugees fleeing Paris in 1940 and discovers sanctuary in her friendship with the farmer's youngest son. Together they play at death, the only game in town. Looking critically together at the visual traces left by our cultural forebears and compatriots is a form of history writing, but also a form of taking responsibility. In his assessment of an archive of British colonial cinema, for example, Paul Gilroy is unequivocal. He says, "We should not underestimate that reckoning with the uncomfortable material that has been assembled. It demands new interpretative approaches and a novel variety of social, cultural, and historical inquiry." He calls for a dialogic spirit of talking to each other and talking to the films, and a consciousness of a common predicament in looking squarely at films that saw the world from the perspective of a powerful imperial imagination. This film was Springtime in an English Village from 1944. It was made by the Colonial Film Unit about twin girls, Stephanie and Connie, who were the daughters of an African seaman who were fostered out to a couple in a Norfolk village in England for safety. The film shows how one of the girls is crowned Queen of the May. The May Festival is a manifestation of English village life, a pagan tradition for the start of summer that was appropriated into Christian symbols and festivals from as early as the 12th century. The problem with Springtime in an English Village is not the subject matter per se, however, but the use for which it was conceived. The target audience were imperial subjects. It was an extremely pretty little film, which we think will have an appeal not only in Africa, but across the whole colonial empire. Its self-conscious pastoral version of integration is perhaps better than exclusion, but looking together with Gilroy, the film is anachronistic and rather insulting to the girls, rather than the endearing vignette intended. Gilroy asks us, or at least this is how I read him, to encounter such films through the eyes not only of the oppressed or infantilized colonial subject, but through the unbound eyes of a pluricultural, contemporary, post-colonial subject. And that includes all of us. I borrow Gilroy's twinning of dialogue and consciousness with a cosmopolitan imagination as a framework for explaining my engagement with a different archive, that of the cinema of child migration, in which Springtime is an early, somewhat self-conscious example. So the migrant child may have travelled over national and continental borders of empire, like Stephanie and Connie in that English village, through worlds of fantasy like Alice Liddell in Lewis Carroll's Fantasy of Childhood as Wonderland, or have remained relatively ordinary and local to a territory or a city street. She may indeed be like the Irish children Dylan and Kylie in a film Kisses by Lance Daly in 2008, which is also a riff on Wizard of Oz. These are two ordinary, but like all children, extraordinary, children who escape family violence and sexual assault for a day and night adventure in the big city. The journey from the depressed suburbs to Dublin would be nothing much for an adult in a car, but for them it entails encounters with strangers and strange ways of travel. It is other migrants, such as the Bob Dylan fan Bargeman, who help them.
по-моему.
Come on. That's a good job, but you are not alone on this vessel. It's against inland cutaway insurance regulation.
Come on, Philip!
No, please, no more jumping!
And of course, other films help us understand other films. They talk to each other. The references that one film makes to another intensifies their connection to longer stories of shared humanity and of history repeated, refined, and remembered. There are references to Dorothy in Kisses. The children buy sparkling red roller sneakers with drug money nicked from Kylie's elder brother. And three migrant friends on the road, the bargeman is one of them, help them survive an otherwise dangerous adventure. There is the bargeman we've seen. There's a prostitute with a magical kiss. She's a bit like the Wicked Witch of the North, but not quite. And a busker who sings Dylan. But there are other echoes too. Dylan and Kylie's barge journey, for instance, reminds me of the escape of young lovers from French provincialism in Jean Vigo's La Talente in 1934. So if we hadn't realized that escape from the suburbs may be as great a journey as a trip to Oz, as extraordinary a feat and potentially a disappointment as anything a child might do, as magnificent an adventure as cinema can make it, then these cumulative stories will hopefully bring that to our attention. Whether the journey is long or short, within national borders or transcontinental, there's not a country on the planet not touched by human mobility. And there are few, if any, examples of human mobility in which children are not moving too. The child migrant as protagonist manifests in a number of guises across several story patterns and genres. She is the child that travels with purpose across internal and external borders in search of somewhere, someone, or something that was better than what is happening at home or wherever the journey has started. This phenomenon, as we all know too well, is current. Just for one example, a news story erupted in 2014 as thousands of child migrants entered the US to escape gang violence in Central America. 52,000 youths between October 2013 and July 2014 have made the trip. Those children are fleeing for their lives and their futures away from home. But the child migrant is also the child that is sent away from home without being consulted, the stolen child. That specific form of abandonment brings commonality between the indigenous girls of Philip Noyce's Rabbit Proof Fence, the Catholic institutionalized kids from the television series The Leaving of Liverpool back in 1992, and more recently the wrecked adult survivors of Jim Loach's Oranges and Sunshine. Stolen in different ways for different reasons, they are nonetheless caught up in a system that could not see children and childhood as sentient, powerful, and whole. Ironically, their enforced journeys give them the insight of the grounded cosmopolitan, whilst it is adults who share the same physical space who refuse that vision. It's not only Australia that steals children and childhood, of course, and indeed a film that might be a million miles away in space and time might still show us the enormity of forced separation for any child anywhere. And I'll show you this clip.
Au revoir, mon père.
Bonnet, Négus et Dupré sont morts à Auschwitz. Le père Jean au camp de Mauthausen. Le collège a rouvert ses portes en octobre 1944. Plus de 40 ans ont passé, mais jusqu'à ma mort, je me rappellerai chaque seconde de ce matin de janvier.
The last frames of Louis Malle's drama of childhood's Au revoir les enfants play out the betrayal of childhood by adults, where waving farewell is the most that one child can do for another. The boy who was a friend and is now identified as other, extraneous, sinfully cosmopolitan, the boy who is now to be murdered in a camp somewhere in Poland, looks back at his friends standing in the relatively safe ranks of the French national subject. Then he leaves, pushed onward and away by a soldier. The door in the wall remains open. The backwards look and the open door are both a connection and a moment of severance between us, you, me, Gilroy, the Catholic French boys, and the migrant. Every child who's pushed out a door and away from the safety of friendship and kinship and belonging to a group. Malle's film earns that moment of shock severance, not by a continuous emphasis on the horrors of the 1940s occupation of France, but on the way friendship is created between boys by the coincidences of their imagination, in play, in adventure, and in music, and the degrees to which a shared cosmopolitan sense, what we could call decency, can preserve the dignity of his protagonists to the last frame. Malle's context was the deportation of Jewish children from Paris in 1942 to Drancy and thence to Auschwitz, Madienek, and so on. Sofia Tukovits's 2014 biographical documentary, Once My Mother, which you could have seen at the Sydney Film Festival this year, and it's on at the Chauvel now if you haven't, discusses the deportations of Polish adults and children to Siberia, also in the early 1940s. Tukovits's docudrama bravely works through the competing childhood memories that interrupt the love between mother and daughter, Helen and Sofia. The tragedy that marks Helen's early life is her deportation to a Soviet prison camp, and the subsequent journey across the Soviet Union and arrivals in camps of one kind and another in the Middle East, Africa, and finally Australia. Hers is the multiple migration experience of the modern refugee from one staging post to another, by air or by land or by sea. It is a life event that has the brutal comfort of historical evidence, photographs, film footage, and estimated numbers of survivors and the dead, a national tragedy of Poland. As such, it is a portion of life become historical artifact that can be looked at dialogically and collectively by the persecuted and their persecutors. But in fact, it was Helen's eviction from her village home onto the city streets at the age of about 10 that is so painfully reenacted in her separation from the 8-year-old Sophia on arrival in Adelaide. And surely that is where much of the pain sits. Helen's disappearance, once my mother, into dementia, revisits the betrayal of Sophia's placement in an orphanage, once my mother, and society that did not support single parents and build a home. The film's patient unwrapping of the causes and sources and repetitions of trauma succeeds in commanding that collective gaze onto the long-term impact of a child's forced mobility and her lifelong search for home. Famously, Marianne Hirsch has identified the post-memory syndrome of second generations, children of survivors and victims. Here, though, the adult shows the child her suffering, in part by making the child feel it in her stead all over again. But despite the seeming abandonment, and although the ghosts in this nursery take the mother from the beloved daughter, the motive is to make a home as best she can. Helen the mother is still Helen the child, Dorothy, a perpetual child migrant still battling her way along the yellow brick road to the Emerald City. Tukovits's film mourns and celebrates her mother's energy, persistence, survival, and belatedly, as we all do with our mothers perhaps, ghosts, brutal childhood ghosts. Sorry, embraces her heartbreaks and impossible, brutal childhood ghosts. The late Stuart Hall's sympathetic reading of the energy of arrival in the otherwise ordinary lives of migrants from former British colonies is used by another theorist, Nirmal Puwar, to discuss social spaces in film. Her approach reinforces the concept of publicness that allows us to relate to shared historical and emotional experience within cinematic structures of fantasy. So an otherwise hidden social phenomenon, the energy of new arrivals, becomes visible, legible, and validated, providing some kind of articulation into everyday life through film. But energy can also burn you up. And when I've talked about this work with ex-child migrants, one says to me, friend, so he said it quite firmly, "I got really angry reading this. She doesn't get it," I said to myself, "it's all blah." And then I realized I was angry because you were leading me to think about my life. So I've lived my whole life outside anything that would embed. When we lived in Cyprus, I couldn't speak my family's language. When we came to England, I nearly could be English, except I couldn't, because my body would betray my words too often. Sometimes I can be proud of being a self-carrying person, but quite often I'm jealous of all those people who know where they belong. But the emotional cost is more than anyone can decently handle, or how contracted, disembedded emotions become because their context is gone, in time as well as space. So in a way, I think you're overly optimistic about the identity of the child migrant, or maybe the role of protagonist is already a fiction for such a person. Michael Winterbottom's film, In This World, takes on the responsibility of engaging with what I've called the collective cosmopolitan gaze through telling the story of an Afghani boy traveling to London with an elder cousin. Their journey is laborious and dangerous, but it's the protagonist's energy against the odds that propels the narrative. They leave a refugee camp in Peshawar, Pakistan. The journey necessitates several border crossings, fraught encounters with police, smugglers, and other migrants. The final stage of their journey by sea to the European mainland is tragic. The boy's travel companion dies in an unventilated container on a ship taking them across the Mediterranean to Italy. The boy is the sole survivor. At this point, breathlessness takes over. His energy is muted, his focus constrained, his imagination disciplined. Two other Francophone films, Welcome and Loin, Far, also deal with the dangers of suffocation, as young migrants learn to breathe inside plastic bags to avoid detection by border police testing for carbon monoxide. Whilst these incidents make arresting drama and of course reference actual cases of suffocation, they also illustrate the condition of forced migration and exile. If you're a migrant, whether compelled by economic hardship or threat to life, you must literally and metaphorically hold your breath until you arrive. And even after arrival, you may be waiting, holding your breath, for years and years, until you have the right to the city and a place called home. But there's also a counter-narrative running through these films. These travellers have experienced a world that is much larger than that known by those who don't travel, or only travel by a direct route to an easily accessed destination. The spatial meaning of "not in this world" refers to death. It also allows us to imagine a world which transforms the child's relation to home once the migration has begun. Home is not in this world or in another. It is in both and none. There's no place like home. That's perhaps why zombie movies begin to make sense as a narrative of migration. In conclusion, I want to return to the cinema of young migrants. This is a short film made by some young people from Guangzhou, including these young people, about 4 weeks ago. It was a group of children. They had 3 2-hour sessions in their drop-in centre, which is in the street in which they live. We talked about what mattered from home, what was precious to them, and how they could turn that into a film. And one group of them made The Treasure Hunt in a migrant street village on the outskirts of Guangzhou.
Oh,
you very much.